Cognitive Psychology, MPC 1, Block 1, Information Processing. In Cognitive Psychology, Learning and Memory, we have four blocks: Information Processing, Intelligence and Creativity, Language, and Problem Solving. So in Block 1 that we are going to do today, we have first unit is Cognitive Psychology Introduction. Second unit is Information Processing in Learning and Memory. Third unit is Neuropsychological Basis of Learning and Memory. And unit 4 is Models of Information Processing. First unit, Cognitive Psychology. Cognitive psychology is the branch of psychology devoted to scientific study of mental processes such as perceiving, remembering, and reasoning. A cognitive psychologist might study how people perceive various shapes, why they remember some facts but forget others, or how they learn language. Like if we have visited to some sort of party and in that a lot of loud music is to be heard, and meanwhile along with that music noises are also there, and in that time we are able to listen to some of the conversation of our friends. How is that possible? Then, during that conversation from far away, someone, if he or she is taking our name, we are able to listen to that. Then how is that possible? So all these concepts can be cleared through cognitive psychology. What is mind? The mind is the set of thinking faculties, including cognitive aspects such as consciousness, imagination, perception, thinking, judgment, language, and memory, as well as non-cognitive aspects such as emotion. The mind creates and controls mental functions such as perception, attention, memory, emotions, language, deciding, thinking, and reasoning. The mind is a system that creates representation of the world so that we can act within it to achieve our goals. Some of the questions that can be there in our mind, which can be solved through cognitive psychology. The questions like, how many times have you carefully proofread written work only to be embarrassed later by an obvious error you overlooked? Have you noticed the difficulty of simultaneously taking notes in class and understanding a lecture? When you dial the telephone directory assistance for a telephone number and do not have a pen to note it down, why do you have to repeat the number until you have dialed it? And why you have to make your call again to enquire the number if someone talks to you before you dial the number? Do you remember the experience of working on a problem or a puzzle that you were unable to solve, but after taking a break from the problem, you subsequently obtained a solution, which is actually called incubation effect? Why do objects look farther away on foggy days than they really are? So, to understand all these questions, we need to read cognitive psychology. Cognitive psychology is a branch of psychology. So what is psychology? It's a science which studies mental processes, experiences, and behavior in different contexts. Different from common sense, like if you have visited any sort of a place where you have found that there is an accident over there, and in that one lady is involved. Suddenly your mind will think that it might be the mistake of the lady. That's your common sense, because you have heard so many stories related to that, so many accidents you have come to know about such incidents where lady was the culprit. So your mind says that she only might be, though it is not right. It might be just the opposite of that. So that kind of common sense we are talking about, that is very different from psychology, which we will be doing. So it's a kind of scientific study, not just based on any kind of presumptions that we have made. Psychology is a multifaceted discipline and includes many subfields of study, such as areas as human development, sports, health, clinical social behavior, and cognitive processes. In brain processes such as remembering, perceiving, feeling, and understanding, experiences such as subjective feelings and behaviors, responses or reaction to the events and actions in the world, also spontaneous activity in order to achieve various goals or motives. We have two types of behavior, simple behavior and complex behavior. Simple behavior is based on stimulus and response, and the complex behavior includes a kind of a chain or many behaviors in a series. Like if you are asked to make a coffee, so you need to know about how much water you require, how much sugar you require, how you have to do go with the thing. So that is a kind of complex behavior which is required to go for making that thing. And then overt behavior and covert behavior. Overt behavior is the behavior that is visible, like what is presented in front of the people, that is overt behavior. And the behavior within, that is your desires, your feelings, whether you are attracted to someone, that is your covert behavior. Then how is psychology structured as a discipline? Seeks to understand and explain how the mind works and how the different mental processes lead to different behaviors. Tries to minimize biases in explanation of behavior and experience in various ways. However, it also recognizes the importance of subjectivity in some cases, though trying to develop a scientific understanding of those phenomena. Psychology draws from two streams of knowledge, one which makes use of the methods in physical and biological sciences, and the other which uses the methods in social and cultural sciences in studying a variety of social phenomena. Failure of mental processes are immediately noticed because they can be frustrating, embarrassing, and sometimes even dangerous. And consequently, such failures become useful tools for psychological analysis of mental phenomena. Intentionally, goals and plans are mental phenomena that of affect that affect behavior. Now, domains of cognitive psychology. Here in the middle, we find the cognitive psychology, and all these areas are the domains of cognitive psychology. So what are they? Cognitive neuroscience, perception, thinking and concept formation, attention, representation of knowledge, consciousness, memory, imagery, language, developmental psychology, pattern recognition, and human and artificial intelligence. So we'll be talking about each of the term one by one here, starting from human and artificial intelligence. It involves the ability to acquire, recall, and use knowledge. It is used to understand concrete and abstract concepts and the relationships among objects and ideas. To understand a long language, to follow instructions, to convert verbal description into actions, to behave according to the rules, and to use knowledge in a meaningful way. Cognitive neuroscience, to explain observation made in laboratories. Every part of the cognitive process from sensation to memory is supported by basic electrochemical processes taking place in the brain and nervous system. Perception, the branch of psychology directly involved with the detection and interpretation of sensory stimuli is perception. The study of perception alone does not adequately account for the expected performance. Other cognitive systems are involved, including pattern recognition, attention, consciousness, and memory. Pattern recognition. The things we sense, see, hear, feel, taste, or smell are almost always parts of a complex pattern of a sensory stimuli. Think about the problem of reading. Reading is a complex effort in which the reader is required to form a meaningful pattern from an otherwise meaningless array of lines and curves. By organizing the stimuli that make up letters and words, the reader may then access meaning from his or her memory. The entire process takes place in a fraction of a second with all the neuroanatomical and cognitive systems involved. Attention. Although we are information gathering creatures, it is evident that under normal circumstances, we are also highly selective in the amount and type of information to which we attend. Our capacity to process information seems to be limited to levels, sensory and cognitive. If too many sensory clues are imposed upon us at any given time, we can become overloaded. If we try to process too many events in memory, we can become overloaded, which may cause a breakdown in performance. Consciousness. Consciousness is defined as the current awareness of external or internal circumstances. For example, when you glance at your watch while studying and it reads 10:42 p.m., you are conscious or aware of that external signal. However, your reading of the time also brings up another conscious thought, one that was initially activated by reading the time but is from inside. That conscious thought might be, it is getting late. I would better finish this chapter and go to bed. Memory. Sensoric memory. Sensoric memory is considered to be outside of cognitive control and is instead an automatic response. The information represented in SM is the raw data, which provides a snapshot of a person's overall sensory experience. Short-term memory or working memory is the capacity for holding a small amount of information in mind in an active, readily available state for a short period of time. Long-term memory is memory in which associations among items are stored. Representation of knowledge. Fundamental of all human cognition is the representation of knowledge, how information is symbolized and combined with the things stored in the brain. This part of cognition has two aspects, the conceptual representation of knowledge in mind and the way the brain stores and processes information. The conceptual representation in different individuals can be considerably different. In spite of these inherent dissimilarities between representation of knowledge, most humans do experience and depict experience in similar enough ways to get along well in the world. The content of this information is also hugely different, but our neurological web entraps information and experiences and holds them in structures that are similar in all human brains. Imagery. Cognitive psychologists are especially interested in the topic of interest representation of knowledge. The mental images of the environment are formed in the form of a cognitive map, a type of internal representation of juxtaposed buildings, streets, street signs, spotlights, and so on. From the cognitive maps, we are able to draw out significant clues. Although the experimental study of mental imagery is relatively new to psychology, some significant research has recently been reported. Language. One form of knowledge shared by all human societies is the knowledge of language. Language is the principal means by which we acquire and express knowledge. Thus, the study of how language is used is a central concern of cognitive psychology. Human language development represents a unique kind of abstraction, which is basic to cognition. Language processing is an important component of information processing and storage. Language also influences perception, a fundamental aspect of cognition. Developmental psychology. Recent studies and theories in development cognitive psychology have greatly expanded our understanding of how cognitive structures develop. As adults, we have all lived through childhood and adolescence, and we share maturational experiences with all members of our species. Thinking and concept formation. Thinking is the crown jewel of cognition. Thinking is the process by which a new mental representation is formed through the transformation of information. Advances in cognitive psychology have led to a formidable arsenal of research techniques and theoretical models. An ability to think and form concepts is an important aspect of cognition. Similar concepts help in the understanding and processing of information. There is a considerable body of knowledge about the laws and processes of concept formation. A brief history of cognitive psychology. Early thoughts on thinking. Where did knowledge come from and how is it represented in the mind? That eternal question is fundamental to cognitive psychology as it has been through the ages of humankind. Basically, two answers have been proposed. The empiricists maintain that knowledge comes from experience, and the nativists suggest that knowledge is based on innate characteristic of the brain. From a scientific perspective, neither case can be definitively proved. So the argument continues without clear resolution. With these issues clearly before us, let's consider the way ancient philosophers and early psychologists grappled with the issue. The fascination with knowledge can be traced to the earliest writings. Early theories were concerned with the seat of thought and memory. Ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics suggest their authors believed that knowledge was localized in the heart, a view shared by the early Greek philosopher Aristotle, but not by Plato, who held that the brain was the locus of knowledge. Cognition in the Renaissance and beyond Renaissance. Philosophers and theologians seemed generally satisfied that knowledge was located in the brain. They considered that knowledge was acquired not only through the physical senses, mundus sensibilis, touch, taste, smell, vision, and hearing, but also from divine sources, mundus intellectualis, deus. During the 18th century, when philosophic psychology was brought to the point where scientific psychology could assume a role, the British empiricists George Berkeley, David Hume, and later James Mill and his son John Stuart Mill suggested that internal representation is of three types. Direct sensory events. faint copies of percepts or those that are stored in memory, and transformation of these faint copies as in associated thought. These notions are the basis of much current research in cognitive psychology. During the 19th century, the early psychologists like Gustav Fechner, Franz Brentano, Hermann Helmholtz, Wilhelm Wundt, G.E. Muller, Oswald Kolpe, Hermann Ebbinghaus, Sir Francis Galton, Edward Titchener, and William James and others started to break away from philosophy to form a discipline based on empirical results rather than on speculation. By the last half of the 19th century, theories of representation of knowledge were clearly dichotomous that emphasized the structure of mental representation and the processes or acts. About the same time in America, James critically analyzed the new psychology that was developing in Germany. He established the first psychological laboratory in America, wrote the definitive work in psychology in 1890, Principles of Psychology, and developed a well-reasoned model of the mind. Perhaps James' most direct link with modern cognitive psychology is in his view of memory, in which both structure and process play an important role. F.C. Donders, James Cattell, contemporaries of James, performed experiments using the perception of brief visual displays as a means of determining the time required for mental operations. Cognitive psychology in early 20th century. The behaviorist views of human and animal psychology were cast in a framework of stimulus response psychology, and Gestalt theorists built elaborate conceptualization of internal representation within the context of isomorphism, one-to-one relationship between representation and reality. Psychological studies of mental processes as conceptualized in the late 19th century suddenly became unfashionable, displaced by behaviorism. Studies of internal mental operations and structures such as attention, consciousness, memory, and thinking were laid to rest and remained so for about 50 years. To the behaviorists, internal states were subsumed under the label of intervening variable that mediated the effects of stimuli on responses and were neglected in favor of making observation on behavior rather than on the mental processes. In 1932, some years before the cognitive revolution swept across psychology, learning psychologist Edward Tolman from the University of California at Berkeley published Purposive Behavior in Animals and Men. In this seminal work, Tolman observed that what rats learn in a maze is the layout of the land rather than simply a series of SR connections. The animal, according to Tolman's interpretation, gradually developed a picture of his environment that was later used to find the goal. This picture was called a cognitive map. Tolman's postulate about cognitive maps in animals did anticipate the contemporary preoccupation with how knowledge is represented in a cognitive structure. Also in 1932, Sir Frederick Bartlett from Cambridge University wrote Remembering, in which he rejected the then popular view that memory and forgetting can be studied by means of nonsense syllables, as had been advocated by Ebbinghaus in Germany during the previous century. In the study of human memory, Bartlett argued the use of rich and meaningful material under naturalistic conditions would yield far more significant conclusions. Bartlett introduced the concept of schema as a unifying theme that describes the essence of an experience. Schema theory plays a central role in modern theories of memory. The fecund ideas of Tolman in America and Bartlett in England highly influenced the thinking of future cognitive psychologists. Cognitive psychology and introduction. As it is today, in the 1950s, interest again began to focus on attention, memory, pattern recognition, images, semantic organization, language processes, thinking, and even consciousness, the most dogmatically skewed concept, as well as other cognitive topics once considered outside the boundary of experimental psychology. Among the most important forces accounting for the new cognitive revolution were the following. The failure behaviorism. Behaviorism, which generally studied overt responses to stimuli, fail to account for the diversity of human behavior as in the case of language. Furthermore, there were some topics ignored by the behaviorists that seemed to be profoundly related to human psychology. These included memory, attention, consciousness, thinking, and imagery. It was apparent that internal mental processes were very real parts of psychology and required investigation. The emergence of communication theory. Communication theory prompted experiments in signal detection, attention, cybernetics, and information theory, areas of significance to cognitive psychology. Modern linguistics. New ways of viewing language and grammatical structure became incorporated into attitudes concerning cognitions. Memory research. Research in verbal learning and semantic organization provided a sturdy empirical base for theories of memory, which led to the development of models of memory systems and the appearance of testable models of the other cognitive processes. Computer science and other technological advances. Computer science, and especially a subdivision of it, artificial intelligence, caused re-examination of basic postulates of problem solving and memory processing and storage, as well as of language processing and acquisition. Research capabilities were greatly expanded by new experimental devices. Cognitive development. Psychologists interested in development psychology discovered an orderly unfolding of abilities with maturation. Notable among developmental psychologists during this period was Jane Paget, who described how children develop an appreciation for concepts from infancy to adolescence. Such progress of abilities seemed to be natural. From the earliest concepts of representational knowledge to recent research, knowledge has been thought to rely heavily on sensory inputs. That theme runs from the Greek philosophers through Renaissance scholars to contemporary cognitive psychologists. But are internal representation of the world identical to the physical properties of the world? Evidence is increasing that many internal representation of reality are not the same as the external reality. That is, they are not isomorphic. Tolman's work with laboratory animals and Barnett's work with human subjects suggests that information from the senses is stored as an abstract representation. Furthermore, studies of neurology clearly show that information from the outside world is sensed and stored as in a neurochemical code. Key issues in the study of cognitive psychology. Nature versus nurture. If we believe that the environment plays an important role in cognition, we might conduct research exploring how distinctive characteristics of environment seem to influence cognition. Rationalism versus imperialism. How should we discover the truth about ourselves and about the world around us? Should we do so by trying to reason logically based on what we already know? Or should we do so by observing and tasting our observation of what we can perceive through our senses? And how can we combine theory with empirical methods to learn the most we can about cognitive phenomena? Structures versus processes. Should we study the structures, contents, attributes, and products of the human mind, or should we focus on processes of human thinking? Domain generality versus domain specificity. Are the processes we observe limited to single domains, or are they general across a variety of domains? Do observation in one domain apply also to all domains, or do they apply only to specific domains observed? Validity of causal inferences versus ecological validity. Should we study cognition by using highly controlled experiments that increase the probability of valid inferences regarding causality? Or should we use more naturalistic techniques? Applied versus basic research. Should we conduct research into fundamental cognitive processes? Or should we study ways in which to help people use cognition effectively in practical situations? Biological versus behavioral methods. Should we study the brain and its function directly, perhaps even scanning the brain while people are performing cognitive tasks? Or should we study people's behavior in cognitive tasks, looking at measures such as percentage correct and reaction time? Key ideas in cognitive psychology. Cognitive science. Three powerful areas of scientific development, namely computer science, neuroscience, and cognitive psychology, converge to create a new science called cognitive science. The boundaries between these disciplines are sometimes hard to distinguish. That is, some cognitive psychologists may be closer to neuroscience, others to computer science. One thing is clear, that is, the science of human cognition is undergoing a radical transformation as a result of major changes in computer technology and brain science. Cognitive psychology makes full use of recent discoveries in neuroscience and computer science that illuminate the cognitive properties of the human species. Neuroscience and cognitive psychology. During the early stages of cognitive psychology, little attention was given to physiological psychology or neuroanatomy. Much of the early information on the brain and its function resulted from head traumas incurred during wars and accidents. The central issue neurologists struggled with was whether the brain was a holistic organ with operation distributed throughout its infrastructure, or whether activities were localized and tied to specific regions. For example, did learning a specific act take place in a localized area of the brain, or was learning distributed throughout many parts of the brain? Among the most prominent of the scientists who wrestled with these issues was Carl Laschley, 1929. Recently, progress has been made in the field of neuroscience, which comprises both the structural aspects of the brain and its peripheral components, as well as functional aspects. With the beginning of the 21st century, cognitive psychology seems poised to make another paradigm shift. While the traditional topics of perception, memory, language, problem solving, and thinking, and the method of experimental analysis are still central to the cognitive theme, as is well known, the use of neurocognitive imagery promises to become one of the major means of investigative cognitive functions in this century. Neurocognitive techniques, which have been developing very rapidly in the past several decades, allow us to see deeper and more clearly into the brain. And the brain is believed to be the engine of cognition. Virtually every area of cognition has been investigated with neurocognitive techniques. These techniques, MRI, PT, EEG, and the like, show not only the structures of cognition, but also processes involved. Computer metaphor and human cognition. Although Pascal, Descartes, and others dreamt of computing machines centuries ago, it was not until the development of high-speed digital computers more than 50 years ago that practical machines were invented. These machines gained enormous acceptance and are presently used in virtually every aspect of modern life. Originally, such devices were thought to be wonderful number crunchers capable of performing a multitude of complex mathematical operations in a fraction of time required by humans. However, it was quickly discovered that they could perform functions that resembled human problem solving. However, what computers do well, perform high-speed mathematical functions and abide by rule-governed logic, humans do poorly, relatively speaking. And what humans do well, form generalization, make inferences, understand complex patterns, and have emotions, computers do poorly or not at all. Despite this problem, a second generation of cognitive computer scientists is working toward building computers that looked something like a brain. These new computers are sometimes called neural networks and act more like humans than the earlier versions. They are able to make generalization and understand complex visual patterns, are slow at math, and make witless mistakes. Although they still do not have emotions, they are nevertheless a mark of success. We now know that there are fundamental differences between the internal workings of computers and the internal workings of the brain. Nevertheless, the computer metaphor continues to have a profound and generally positive impact on the development of cognitive psychology. Now at the end, unit 10 questions. Describe the major historical schools of psychological thought leading up to the development of cognitive psychology. Analyze how various research methods in cognitive psychology reflect empirist and rationalist approaches to gaining knowledge. Design a rough sketch of a cognitive psychological investigation involving one of the research methods described in this chapter. Highlight both the advantages and disadvantages of using this particular method for your investigation. Describe cognitive psychology as it is today. How might you speculate that the field will change in the next 50 years? How might an insight gained from basic research lead to practical use in an everyday setting? Describe some real life situation related to different domains of cognitive psychology. How might an insight gained from applied research lead to deepened understanding of fundamental features of cognition? What was the importance of the computer to the development of cognitive psychology? Next time you visit a supermarket or mall, pause for a few moments and observe the various examples of cognitive psychology which surround you. Pay particular attention to the use of forms and colors to gain attention, your own reaction to environmental cues, the use of memory in understanding language, context, and the interpretation of sights and sounds of your environment. Note down your impressions of these matters and read them over in about a week. What principles discussed in this chapter apply? Thank you so much. This was the material from IGNU. IGNU, Material Cognitive Science.